Welcome to Running for Real, a global community with a shared love and curiosity for running. Together, we reconnect with the reasons why we love to run and discover ways it helps us become better people. Whether it's the quiet moments of a morning run while the rest of the world still sleeps, or befriending the strangers next to you at the start line of a race, we are here to connect with others who see running as the common thread that weaves our lives together. Come join me, Tina Muir, as I talk with people from all walks of life, united by a love of running. Hello, my friends. Welcome to episode 328 of the Running for Real podcast. Thank you for joining me today. As always, I am excited that you are here. And before we go on to talk about anything else, I just want to ask you a quick favor. Can you quickly get out your phone, go to reviews on iTunes if you are listening to iTunes, or Spotify going to the equivalent, and just, or wherever else you listen to your podcast, just go leave a review. It's been quite a while since we had some reviews on the podcast, and your 5-star reviews make all the difference. They really do help to get the podcast out there. They help to push it up the suggested on iTunes, and I would just really appreciate your support. If you have been enjoying this podcast for a while, if you do like the Together Runs, please go over to iTunes, leave a rating and review. If you are having trouble, there is links in the show notes explaining how to do that. Thank you so much for taking the time out of your day. That really is so appreciated. Today, I am excited to welcome Nick Cutsumpas to the podcast. Nick is someone that I am excited to bring on the show because he's someone I met in person a few months ago. We are both on the All Good Collective, All Birds All Good Collective program. We are massive All Birds fans. We appreciate and recognize all the work that they are doing, and you'll hear a little bit more about that later. But primarily, Nick is a plant coach. He's an author. He's an urban gardener and landscaper. He was also on Netflix's Instant Dream Home. His book, Plant Coach, is out now. You're going to hear us talk a little bit about that. But actually, we go on to talk about other things, including what running means to him. And he's just really fun. If you don't follow him, Farmer Nick on Instagram, you definitely should. And yeah, this is just going to be a really fun interview. So let's go ahead and thank one of our sponsors. Then we'll be right to this episode with Nick. Just taking a pause from this episode to introduce you to our brand new partner. I am very excited to welcome Oladance as a Running for Real partner. Now, what are Oladance, you ask? They are these wearable stereo headphones that you can wear while running that are crystal clear. The sound is unparalleled in the running headphone space. I absolutely love it. And it's got the open ear design. They are true comfort for podcast listeners, for runners. It doesn't matter whether you're doing your chores or whether you're out for a run, whether you slow down on that run to take a little walk. It won't be that vibrating feeling for me that gave me a real headache. There also won't be loss of sound when it is windy. They have the open ear design. It never enters your ear, so there's no ear fatigue. And we all know what that is after COVID. But it's going to also prevent hearing loss from having earbuds in constantly. It is ideal for podcast listening. And if you wear headphones more than 2 hours a day, Oladance is a must have. It also has a secure fit, and I can attest to this. You know me, I will have been testing this out for a while, and I am absolutely loving the secure fit. It stays firmly on my ears regardless of what activity I'm doing. And the sound, I've mentioned the sound already. It has a 3 times bigger dynamic driver. It's a wearable stereo, and there's 360 degrees sound, which is just great. Finally, I want to talk about safety. So for us as runners, we obviously want to be able to keep ourselves safe. That is our number one priority. And I love that these are open ear designed so that you can hear outside sounds. But like I said, the sound quality of whatever you're listening to is also great. So you won't have to lose track of what's happening around you, and it'll keep you safe while also allowing you to be in the moment. It is made for people who love to move, love to shake, and of course, love to run. so you, my friend, can go to oladance.com/Tina. That's oladance.com/Tina. That's oladance.com/Tina. And if you use code Tina, you will save 20% on your order. I am loving these headphones. These are the ideal gift for a loved one in your life, and I cannot wait to hear what you think too. Go check it out, oladance.com/Tina. Nick, welcome to the Running For Real podcast. Is this your first running podcast you've ever been on?
Thanks, Tina. This is safe to say definitely my first running podcast. I wouldn't necessarily call myself a runner, but I'm excited to be here nonetheless.
You would not. What do you think you need to do to class yourself as a runner?
I mean, I run like once or twice a week, usually in the range of 1 to 3 miles. I'm a big 5K guy. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it's, I view runners as like hitting the pavement, you know, 3, 4, 5 times a week.
Would you ever want to build up to that or have zero desire?
You know, I would like to in some ways. I really do want to try to do a sprint marathon in the new year.
Wait. I got to call you out for that. What is a sprint marathon?
Like a half marathon. No, not sprint marathon. A sprint triathlon. You can see how much I know about endurance training, right? Yes, a sprint marathon would be like a mile.
What are you talking about?
Yeah, I would do a sprint triathlon, which is, I think, probably the most cardio I would ever do. But for me, I've had actually 2 major knee surgeries. Mm. So the doctor was like, yeah, all that running on the pavement is not always the best for you. So okay. I can feel it a little bit.
So wait, how old were you when you had knee surgeries?
Sophomore in college. Oh. I was 19, tore ACL, MCL, meniscus, and broke my leg.
Ouch.
And then 4 years later, tore the ACL again. So yeah, it was a rough go on that left knee.
Yeah, your knees have been through it. That is not fun. And I'm glad you came out the other side, because as I watched you walk, you did not seem to be walking weirdly. So doesn't seem to have affected you long term.
I'm big on posture and form. So I was a former personal trainer in a different life. So okay. I'm very, very attuned to those things.
Well, that's good. And good you are able to be an example for people that after they've had knee surgeries, it's not the end of the road. You can sit on the couch for the rest of your life.
Yeah, exactly. Always in motion. Stay in motion. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so we're going to talk a little bit about running and what it does for you, but I do want to talk about some other things. Firstly, we kind of talked about this a little bit, but I'm going to be honest, I was a little bit nervous about my plants around, because I have these around, but I feel like, are they impressive enough to be in my background?
Hey, it's not a matter of how impressive your plants are. All that I care about is that you care about those plants and you want to take care of them, because that's the key, right? If you care, then you're going to start caring about other larger environmental causes and things in the world around you.
Yes. Okay. Well, I want to dig in that. First, I want to point out, I want to brag for a minute. This is propagated. Can I just take that?
Beautiful monstera cutting. Yes.
Isn't that? I'm really proud of that. Yep.
I see that new leaf poking out there.
It's happy.
Yeah.
Anyway. Okay. So larger environmental things. This is a passion of yours and mine. And I recently had honestly, that was one of my favorite evenings of the year, going to plant potluck a few months ago. That was just such a powerful evening for me. A lot of my audience has heard me talk about it in varying capacities and just how beautifully you navigated that in terms of setting it up. And I know this is a big passion of yours. You love doing these. And you said you've done like 7?
We're almost at, I think the next one's going to be the 10th.
10. Okay. All right. So yeah. You've done quite a few of these. There was about 50 people there. It was in your backyard with you and your roommates. Do you call them roommates?
Yeah, I got roommates.
Well, I don't know if you, I mean, your place seems a bit more than like a typical, like what I would think of as a roommate, like apartment mates.
We got a big house. So yes. 4 bedrooms, 4 roommates. It's not so bad.
Yeah. And it was all plant-based, which gave me so much life to see all these people who were eating plant-based. It made me so happy. And I've decided, I haven't told you this, I've decided to replicate it at my house, except...
No way.
Wait, there's an added complication in that almost everyone I'm inviting has children under 10. So do you think this is going to go smoothly?
Whoa, that is a curveball for sure. But as someone who is an aspiring dad myself, I fully support this. That's awesome.
Let's see how it goes. I've got a nice finished basement. So figured I'll shovel the kids downstairs and the rest of us can have nice conversations.
Nice.
I'm fully expecting it to just be a total disaster. But I did do the step you did. And I want to say this to encourage other people to do this. You had everyone bring our own silverware or cutlery, as I say, plate and reusable thing, which I will admit in this moment that I did not bring because I was traveling.
You're traveling. That's okay.
And so I did not have a plate at hand. And at that time I had forgotten my utensils, but I really loved that. And I'm trying to replicate that. So I guess, would you like to make a pitch for people in changing the way that they view gatherings? We are in a time when there's a lot of gatherings happening. There's a lot of like, this is the way things have always been done, even though we all know that's not the way things have always been done. But in recent 50 years, that's the way things have been done. What would you like to remind people going into these hosting seasons about, yeah, just the impact you can have? They don't have to fill up 17 trash bags in it for a reckoning.
I mean, the holidays in general are a major, major time for waste of all kinds, whether it's gifts or hosting, what have you. I think the biggest thing for me was realizing like, okay, if I'm hosting and organizing this and inviting people into my home, I think that earned me the right to ask a very small step from my attendees and my guests and say, hey, listen, if I'm going to bring you into my space, I would love it if you could share, at least for one night, the values that I have when it comes to the environment and reducing our waste. So it's not a huge ask. I'm not asking them to, you know, go vegan full time or go completely zero waste in their own life, but asking them to say, hey, you know, could you bring some cutlery and a cup and a plate just so that we can make it easier, not just on me, but also on the earth as well. And everyone who is not traveling from out of state is able to bring their stuff, and it makes for a really simple and clean event. And at the end of it, I don't have to worry about the dishes or throwing away tons of plastic plates. It's a beautiful thing to see people come together around it.
And would you say, granted, you live in, was it not Malibu?
Like Brentwood area.
Santa Monica, right? I was with my friend, so I wasn't really paying attention to where I was. Granted, you live in California, but would you say that people are generally receptive to that? Because it seems maybe such a, even for me as someone, all my friends know how passionate I am about this, but it still seemed like I was like, send the email. It does seem like a big deal.
It certainly is. I think where you have these hubs of sustainability, people immediately think California, New York. But there are plenty of other hubs. They're just smaller. And there are so many folks who live in more rural communities or in the Midwest where they feel like they're on an island. But I think that there are more people that care about these issues that you just might not know about. It's almost, I don't want to say it's taboo to talk about these issues, but there are certainly people who feel less confident in sharing them outwardly. I have a friend who lives in Arkansas and she reps it. She's like, listen, I'm in Arkansas. I'm zero waste. I'm doing all these things for the environment. I'm not perfect, but she is starting that dialogue and conversation. And I think just doing that in an area that's less conventionally known for some of those topics is so important because it empowers others who have been thinking about it. And for me and my audience, like as much as I love catering to my New York and California folks, I want the person in St. Louis to say, hey, that's cool. You know, because of you, I am hosting my own event or doing this or doing that. So I think it's really important, no matter where you live, to find that community, even if it's small to start with.
So true. Do you ever have moments in your own life, you said, you know, not perfect. And even with you being in California or New York, which is where you spend most of your time, do you ever have situations where you are being, I'm sure you've had this situation where you've been in like a restaurant or something and you see them going to put it in a plastic tub and you're like, no,
There's so many plastic fails. Oh my gosh. Every day, right? I mean, I was in New York and I was grabbing lunch and, you know, I forget where I was. I think it was at like Dig, which is one of my favorite spots. Mm-hmm. And I said, hey, you know, she starts to put on the top. I was like, oh, I don't need that. I'm good. Like, I'm just going to go eat in the park. And she goes, okay. And then she throws it away anyway.
Yes, that's the worst.
No, that is almost worse. Yeah. It didn't even get any utility. And there's moments like that. It happens, right? You know, I go to a restaurant, you're talking with your friend, you order something, and you forget to ask, oh, can it be in a glass cup? Or, oh, mm-hmm. I don't need a straw with that, or whatever it might be. So there's failures along the way, but just slowing down and being very present helps and reminds you to ask some of those questions ahead of time.
So true. And I'm glad to hear you say that because, I mean, that Dig situation, I've had that kind of thing so many times. Like, I've even brought my own spoon to get ice cream and then been like, I don't need a spoon. And they're like, okay. But then like habitually they start paying in. It's like slow motion. You're like, no, I don't want the spoon. And they're like, oh, okay. And you're like, no, now I've just... Ah.
Yep.
So yeah, that's...
It's funny. I seldom get ice cream, but when I do get ice cream, mm-hmm. I always get the cone because I don't want, you know, the cup and I don't want the spoon or whatever. Mm-hmm. So I ordered a cone over the summer and they put a little spoon in the cone. I was like, no, this is just not right.
So yeah, it's nice to talk to someone who feels equally as like flustered around things that most people don't even give a second thought to. But I will say that I feel like I've finally been able to let go of some of those things, whereas in the past I would get so angry when someone would make a mistake like that. Like, I told you I didn't. I wouldn't actually yell at them, but in my head I'd be like, well, I told you I didn't want that. And I feel like I've been able to let go of that. But I think it's important, as you mentioned, to just begin changing the conversation and also the people you are with, just thinking like, oh, I don't know if I need that, or you know, maybe I can just maybe I don't need a plastic bag to carry my one cupcake in. So it's just good to keep reminding people to keep kind of shaking things up, even if at times it's hard for people to work their head around it.
Exactly. We are so habituated in our mm-hmm. daily lives and our routines. So just learning to ask that first question is going to break free from that a little bit, and then you'll see it totally differently the next time you go back.
Mm-hmm. So related to that, how do you handle kind of guilt around, I've talked to you about this on the phone before, just like off air, but how do you handle the guilt around either traveling or things that you do within your work?
Yeah, both of those aspects are really complex for me, right? You know, I, of all my friends, probably have the biggest carbon footprint because I'm traveling a lot. Mm-hmm. I'm not necessarily traveling for pleasure. I'm traveling mm-hmm. for community garden activism around the country. I'm traveling to go to an event in Sweden that is promoting, you know, the next wave of eco-friendly furniture and home design, right? So there's a purpose to much of that travel, but still, you know that flying is arguably one of the worst things that you can do. Obviously, I live across the country away from my family. That is also difficult. And I try and when I go home, make sure that I'm staying for longer periods of time mm-hmm. so I don't have to go back and forth if I know there's a work trip nearby. Mm-hmm. So there's only so much that I can control from that aspect of the business. Mm-hmm. That said, you know, I know folks who say I don't travel for work and I don't do these things. And I'm not at the point in the luxury where I can do that yet. It's where I'm working towards. And I know that for me, it's what are the other behaviors outside of my work that I can maximize my personal impact? Going vegan was one of those things. Mm-hmm. You know, animal agriculture accounts for more carbon emissions than the entire transportation system. So being able to do those different behaviors that are outside of the business stuff that I have to do, which I know I'm promoting environmentalism through my business, it justifies it a little bit more for me. And I'm always striving to make it more efficient, whether it's really researching carbon offset programs, which I know can be very hit or miss depending on who is operating them, but just being very cognizant of ways that I can make it easier when it comes to some of that travel and some of the other aspects of the business. Because at the end of the day, plants come in plastic nursery pots that can't be recycled. And that is the bane of my existence and drives me crazy. But if I can feel that this plant being in this space is going to inspire the owner of that plant to look at that landscape and say, you know what? I want to change other behaviors in my life. I want to start focusing on how to be a better steward of the earth now that I'm exposed to it and I can see and appreciate it in my own life.
Thank you to Allbirds for partnering with Running for Real and allowing us to continue the work that we are doing. It is really appreciated. And today, my friends, I want to talk to you about the fact that Nick is also a fellow All Good Collective member, which means we are just people who represent Allbirds and we're in a community who are just recognizing the work that Allbirds is doing. Now, you've heard me talking about the tree flyers. These are their shoes to go faster and further. They're lightweight, super springy, wildly comfortable. This distance running shoe is going to make those extra efforts feel effortless. They are the shoe that I wear for probably, if I run, let's say 6 days a week, I wear them for 3 to 4 days a week. I love them. I do my long runs in them. I've run 3 marathons in them. They have this Swift foam, which is a high performance midsole, big on cushion and energy return, making those long runs easier on your body. So you can go to allbirds.com to check out the tree flyers. Nick also talked about the plant leather shoes that he likes. You'll see him talking about that a lot on his social media, but we are both big fans of the work that Allbirds is doing. So not only are you supporting me, you're supporting Nick, and you're supporting a company that's trying to do things better. And they really are going all the way. I have had plenty of time to get to know people all the way through Allbirds, and every person cares so deeply for this planet and making things better. So go to allbirds.com, go check it out. You can check out some of my favorite items. You can check out, I don't know what other items of Nick's to tell you, but you can always take a look on his social media. You'll see he's always wearing Allbirds or using Allbirds. So go check that out. So go to Allbirds, that's allbirds.com, allbirds.com. So true. It's that example of like the seeds being planted. And similarly, you said about the plant pots there. I was in New York doing an event with New York Road Runners, which is one of the biggest running organizations out there, before the New York Marathon. And I hosted a plogging event with them, which is picking up trash while running, in case you learned a new word there. I hosted this event and I said to the group about planting seeds, about how important it is to just inspire other people. And while, as you can imagine, or as you know yourself, trash in New York, especially right now, is quite a problem, especially in certain parts, the amount of people who said thank you or who yelled or said, that's amazing what you're doing, or like, I'd like to hope that those people then went on to do something or thought about it a little bit more, having seen those actions. And even though that trash we picked up is probably going to be that amount dumped again within a week, it still is good to think about all the people who maybe just could have taken some grain of education in that and thought about their own lives and what they could do. And you never know the impacts of that. And that's a lot of what you and I do in our work is, kind of thinking about the bigger purpose, the bigger picture of getting environmentalism in people's heads on a day-to-day basis.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. It's just exposure, exposure, exposure. That is the key.
I'm curious, when you said about you would like to get to the point where you don't travel, do you really think you could ever reach a point where you wouldn't, like, you'd be happy staying in one place?
Whew, asking the tough questions here.
Isn't tough. You got harder ones ahead of that. I'm getting started.
for me, the goal and kind of the North Star is to create a space for my own future family and life where I can make my world that space. Uh-huh. So this would be, and this is me manifesting here, but 5 to 10 acre farm where I am using an acre to grow food. I'm using other acres for rescue animals. Mm-hmm. I'm using different parts of the land to grow different things that, from a landscaping perspective, I can use in my business, so I don't have to rely on other nurseries, right? You know, if you can create that space, then people will come to you, right? I would love to have it be a venue and have it be a space for agritourism, build a couple little tiny homes on the property and have it be something where people can congregate and host events and do different things. And if I can do that, then if the brand says, hey, we're thinking of doing an event here, I'm like, no, let's do it here. Mm-hmm. So I don't have to go anywhere. Because I also don't want to travel one day as much because I want to be there for my future kids and be there with my family and my animals and my plants. My plants hate me now because I'm gone all the time. And I come back and they're like, oh, you. Yeah, we've been gone for 2 weeks. You know, what are you going to do? So I would love to kind of centralize my space and use that to reduce the amount of travel that I do for my business.
Okay. Well, I want to dive into your plants. That leads in perfectly. But I want to just firstly say, I did see you with, I can't remember the name of the guy who had his kid with him. It was so cute watching you. Like, I can tell that's something like deep in your heart. And so, you know, I'm excited to hear about that someday, because it was very clear that that is something that is meaningful to you and just going to be very good at. So I want to mention that there. Okay, so you said about your plants hate you. One of the things I noted down when I was thinking about what we were going to talk about was your, and I know these are popular because the fact it's pinned to your profile, but the plant versus human videos that you do.
Yes.
One of my favorite things to watch on the internet. I would love to hear about how that came up how you came up with that. So basically explain what it is and where that came from.
Yeah. So the human versus plant series was something I started during the middle of the pandemic back in 2020. Mm-hmm. And I'm home with all my plants. Plants were having a huge moment. And I think that trend has kind of carried on through the pandemic, but I realized, like, okay, there's a lot of new plant parents out there and I want them to better connect with their plants. And I, you know, at the time was always naming my plants and talking to them. And I'm like, okay, well, what if my plant talked back? And I, as the human, would act as the kind of, you know, silly, kind of stupid human who doesn't really know what they're doing and is asking the plant for advice on certain things. Mm-hmm. And for me, you know, it's social media can be a lot of things, but the information is not new. It's just how you deliver it that makes people laugh or smile or absorb information differently. That's the key for me. And if I can have a conversation with my plant as a human and the plant is saying, listen, human, you're doing it all wrong. Here's how you handle fungus gnats, or here's how I should be watered properly. I feel like that information is going to stick with folks. Mm-hmm. And so far it's been pretty resounding in terms of people really, you know, resonating with the content and feeling like that's them. They're that human. And, you know, yes, you're anthropomorphizing the plants a little bit, giving them a voice and human qualities. But if that helps you build empathy for the plants in your collection, I think that's amazing.
Absolutely. I often think about that, about if plants had a voice or trees had a voice, like what would they be saying about us, like with all they've seen and all they've experienced?
Probably not a lot of nice things.
No, especially the trees. They're probably just, yeah.
Yeah.
Have you read the book,
The Hidden Life of Trees?
That's it. Yeah. 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 So good. Yeah. And that just blew my mind in terms of thinking about, well, maybe sad in many ways, just the way that how we do not get it about anything. So perfectly, what your video is trying to say, that humans just don't understand so much and yet we think we know everything. But no, I really enjoyed those videos, so I encourage people listening to go check those out. Your profile is Farmer Nick. You really made this business, this lifestyle around a love of plants, a love of nature, a love of our planet. And you recently had something come out, so maybe you could share a little bit about what that is.
Yeah. So last month in October, I had a book come out, which was very exciting, called Plant Coach, The Beginner's Guide to Caring for Plants and the Planet. And it combines my love of plants with my environmentalism. And the thesis of the book really revolves around this idea that plants are stepping stones towards sustainability. They are that botanical bridge that will allow you to connect differently with the nature that is around you that you might not have seen before. There's this phenomenon known as plant blindness, where we could be in a space and not acknowledge or even notice the plants that are around us, be it a park or trees or wherever it might be. And it's my goal with this book, not only to, you know, give you plant care advice, because there's, you know, a whole guide on that, but really redefine the relationship that you have with plants and viewing your home as a living, breathing ecosystem with nature that is not furniture. We think just because we watch on HGTV, they put a fiddly fig in a windowless basement, that that's okay. But the more we can view it as we are members of a larger ecosystem, the easier it will be for us to take care of our plants with that new shift in perspective.
I'm curious. I feel like a lot of the, I guess, our parents' generation, and I think you're similar age to me, our parents' generation, I mean, I remember seeing houseplants and I remember them being around, but do you think there's been a shift in, like, how do you think they viewed plants in the home? Because I remember plants being in my home growing up and I remember plants being in other people's homes, but I don't feel like they maybe had that attention and that view as an ecosystem. Any thoughts on that?
I would agree with that. I think the biggest thing with that generation was the connection of plants to the environmental movement that was missing in many ways. Mm-hmm. I think the reason plants are so trendy now, I say trendy, you know, with quotation marks, because it's more than a trend, but I think they're sticking because we are more aware of our climate issues than ever before. And if you are a millennial or Gen Z person living in an apartment and you want to feel connected to nature and this movement as a whole, the easiest way to do that is to care for plants and feel like you are nurturing something, as opposed to our parents' generation, where I know houseplants had a huge boom in the 80s. It was just more so, oh, let's just put plants here and have it look a certain way. And believe me, there's still plenty of that that exists now. But I think it is so closely tied to our innate sense of wanting to protect the environment. And I think a lot of younger folks are really driven by that message.
Do you happen to know, or have you done any research on, in the past, was it, I mean, now I think there's very much a, if a, you've talked about this, if a plant is in your home is not looking great, that doesn't necessarily mean it's dead, throw it out. Do you know if there's any change in that as well, that they maybe in the past would have been like, oh, this is dead, I'm going to get rid of it?
You know, I think it's the opposite, actually.
Oh, really?
Okay. I think now we're more likely to toss it because our world is so much faster. It's very instant gratification. Oh, you're not serving me? See you later. And there are times where I'll do it, where if I know that this plant is causing problems or it might be infested, I'm not necessarily going to go the great lengths to save it because I've got 120 other plants that I don't want to put at risk, right? Sometimes addition by subtraction is necessary, but I think the biggest thing for me is showing people how plants can slow us down. Our world is so fast. I was working a corporate job for the first 6 years out of university, and I was so fast and this and that, and energy was up in New York City and rah, rah, rah. And then all of a sudden I get into plants and I'm like, ooh, this I have no choice but to be slow. It is a slow, patient exercise and practice. And I cannot sit down and meditate, but I can be there with my plants for an hour in silence.
Just I love that.
Working through it and taking care of them. And that is the way that I can find a moment of zen and solitude with myself.
That's so important. I'm interested to see how I have a 2-year-old and a 4-year-old. I can't remember if I mentioned that to you before, but my 4-year-old, she is very interested in all my plants now. And the Monstera I have downstairs, the one that this one came off, is very big, as they always do, as they always grow to, very constantly adding new leaves. And she will, like look for new ones, and then she'll be like, oh, welcome to the world, and she'll like give it a kiss when it's fully unfolded the leaves. And so I'm curious to see, I've heard her say to her friends before walking outside, like, oh, what a beautiful day. And kind of them like, yeah, sure.
You're teaching her to appreciate.
I know.
That's
but
the
I'm
key.
Interested to see how that rubs off onto other people, or if that gets squashed in her once she goes off to school. So we'll see. Mm.
Yeah, the innocence of childhood and that mm-hmm. sense of curiosity and appreciation. I do think it gets kind of snuffed out in many ways, especially with the education system, which is a whole other conversation for a different podcast. But, you know, that childlike sense of wonder is so important. Mm-hmm. And it's something I try and maintain, especially when visiting new places where the plant life is so different and there's always something new to discover.
Mm-hmm. For sure. No, I very much feel the same. And you mentioned that you, houseplants are like a stepping stone towards just environmentalism and caring. Talking about running, talking about traveling, I'm assuming you do some maybe runs here and there when you are traveling. What have you found that on those runs you pay more attention to your surroundings and being out in nature? Is that a time when you use it to focus in? Like what is it for you?
Those runs are actually some of my most unproductive fitness runs because I'm constantly stopping to be like, ooh, look at this. Gotta take a picture. I was in Portland recently, and when I'm traveling, running is the way to go, right?
Yeah.
Running is the easiest thing for me. I pack a few resistance bands, but I'm doing bodyweight workouts and I'm running because I get to explore. Mm-hmm. And I'm in Portland and I did a long run, actually. I did an 8 mile.
Oh.
8 mile run. Yeah. Impressive. Look at me. Yeah. Look at me. And I'm running around this park. And
is it the Forest Park?
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, so beautiful in there.
Beautiful. Oh, so beautiful. And I'm like, wow, this is great. And I think part of me, you know, ran 8 miles because I was just kind of lost in it. And I kept wanting to see, oh, what's around the bend here? What's around this turn? Mm. So running and just being anywhere with me can be a hassle because I'll be like, oh, stop talking immediately and just go over and take a picture of a plant. It is what it is. It comes with the territory.
I love that. And I very much feel the same a lot of the time. I'll be walking around with a friend and I'll see a tree and I'm like, oh, wow, look at that tree. And they're like, yeah, it's a tree. I'm like, give a look at it. So I feel you. you said about running being a time to really explore. What else has running been for you as you've worked your way through this journey from corporate job to just being immersed in nature in every way?
Mm. Running for me is very cathartic. Mm. I use it to kind of process things that I'm feeling, and we'll pair it with certain types of music or audiobooks or things that I'm trying to kind of get out. Mm-hmm. You know, one funny story is in college, I was in middle of finals week, written 2 10-page essays, was ready to send them in, and my laptop just dies, just dead.
Oh.
And it's like literally the night before. And I was like, okay, that's not ideal. So the first thing I did was put on my running shoes and I just sprinted as fast as I could for about 1.5 miles. And I was like, okay, it's all out. Time to pull my first and only all-nighter. And I did. And that was the only way I could reach that place of balance and homeostasis. So it served a very defined purpose. Now I go on what I call my sad boy runs, where if I'm feeling at all sad about anything or upset about something, I've got a whole playlist, John Mayer, Adele, Harry Styles, it's all on cue. And I'm just running because I'm sad and it's great. I'm in it and it motivates me. So it's not like the typical, you know, hip hop, rap, upbeat music. Like I'm running to sad music and it makes me feel awesome.
Do you run to sad music every time or just when you're feeling sad?
Not every time. Not every time. Okay. I mean, if I'm feeling great, yeah, I'm going to, you know, do something more upbeat and going to pump me up a little bit. But my sad boy runs, I'm a big fan.
Is your playlist literally called Sad Boy?
It's called Sad Boy. Yeah.
Oh, that's so cute. Boy. Is it a public playlist?
I think it might be, actually. I'm not sure. I'll have to look at that.
That's funny. I take it that's on Spotify. We'll have to add it to the
my sad boyness. Yeah.
Yeah. No, I find that really helpful too when I'm feeling sad about something. I love putting on, like you said, John Mayer, Adele, or one of the I have certain songs that I go to and I feel like I need them to like get that out of me. So I'm with you there. I don't necessarily combine it with a run, but I feel like I need it to process.
I mean, I've set some of my PRs after some very sad or frustrating moments in my life. I'm like, ooh, this is a trend that I don't know if I like it, but it's something I'm observing.
Mm-hmm. And so you said to me before we started recording that for you running, doing, it was baseball and basketball?
I played baseball and basketball in high school and then baseball in college.
Yeah. And so you said running, as with most people, was a form of punishment. How have you untangled that? Or how did you get to that point where you were prepared to do it outside and use it as a sense of wonder rather than it being this punishment?
I think the biggest thing for me was realizing that I don't have to run to the point where I feel like I'm going to throw up. Like basketball, it was doing different sprints and all these different things where it's like, I literally felt like I was going to pass out half the time. Mm-hmm. And now I push myself for sure, but I don't need to push myself to that level to get the fulfillment. And if I did, I don't think I would enjoy it as much. There are times like I do the Murph challenge every year.
What is that?
Where it's a fitness challenge you do around Memorial Day. It's a Navy SEAL workout where you do a mile run, 100 pull-ups, 200 push-ups, 300 squats, and then another mile, and you're wearing a 25-pound weight vest.
Wow.
Wait,
for all of that?
Yeah. Oh,
wow.
Yeah, it's tough. Yeah. And that is my time to like, okay, I'm pushing it to the extreme here. Mm-hmm. And that's not my typical. My typical run, you know, I'm doing a 5K or a mile and a half before a workout. And I'm just trying to loosen up the body, feel good. And I'm not a fast runner. I'm usually averaging around like 7 minutes, 7:15.
I'd say for most people listening, that's probably still pretty fast.
I mean, compared to some of my other runner friends, like they're like, oh, that was a jog. And I was like, oh yeah, totally. But you know, I like doing the shorter runs because I also don't have the time, I don't think, always to knock out an hour. Mm-hmm. If I'm traveling, yes, but I like to do a little bit of weight training too.
Thank you to Athletic Greens for partnering with Running For Real and myself and allowing us to continue the work that we are doing. Now, today, I want to talk to you about Athletic Greens. This time of year, it is especially important to consider this because not only are you getting 75 high-quality vitamins, minerals, and whole food source ingredients, this comprehensive nutrition in one single scoop, which is how I start my day every day, even if I'm going immediately out the door on a run, it doesn't upset my stomach, it just is an ideal way to start my day. You're also building a daily habit in 1 minute, and it's going to promote your gut health, support your immunity, boost your energy, and more. Not only those things, but with your order, when you sign up through my code by going to athleticgreens.com/Tina, you are going to get a 1-year free supply of vitamin D3 and K2, plus 5 free travel packs. The vitamin D element is so important this time of year for most of us. We are coming into the winter. This is a time when our vitamin D levels drop. And if you let your vitamin D levels drop too much, it's going to wreak havoc with your training and with your life. It really is so important for us to keep that as we are not getting the vitamin D exposure from the sun. And I love that Athletic Greens has decided that they are going to give us the opportunity to put those two things together so you have everything you need in one scoop. I love having it every morning. I know it is going to take care of my gut, take care of my immunity, boost my energy, and help with recovery through superfoods, adaptogens, and antioxidants. It's like your insurance policy. So no matter what you eat in that day, you know you have given your body nutrient-dense foods, you have taken care of it, and you can go about your day and enjoy this season. So go to athleticgreens.com/Tina to check it out. That's athleticgreens.com/Tina. Okay. Thank you for sharing that. And you needed your weight training, something we haven't mentioned that. Yeah, I want to go back to your book in a minute. But you are also one of the, I don't know what the word would be, cast?
Yeah.
Hosts, there you go, of Instant Dream Home on Netflix, which where may be where people recognize your voice or your picture from. But see, that is a really hard one for me to stretch to bring across to running. So, but I do want to recognize it. I did watch some of them after we went to that potluck, just to like see, because obviously you were there, Adair was there, and Paige was there, and I didn't really know what it was. So, yeah. I went to watch a few of those. But what has that process been like, being involved in something on Netflix? I can imagine that's obviously brings a lot of good, but does it bring some thoughts of imposter syndrome, of being critical of yourself, finding it hard? What are some tough things around it? Because you don't want your life to be too easy here. A fungus gnat just flew by my face.
Oh, typical. Standard. Just another day at the office here. Instant Dream Home was, to allude to my faux pas earlier, a sprint marathon. That literally is what it felt like, because you are renovating these homes in literally one day.
And you really do that.
Truly, right? Okay. There's tons of prep that happens before.
Yeah.
Don't get me wrong. There's 3 months of prep at least for each home. And the day of, you are literally running everywhere for, you know, 12 hours plus. And it was one of those experiences that I will never forget. I will forever be grateful for it. It is one of those things where you do feel an element of imposter syndrome, because you're not able to fully be present for every aspect of the work that you would normally do. So for example, on a landscaping job, you know, I'm going to be in the trenches with my team 24/7 working on X, Y, and Z. There, I have to be there with the landscaping team, but then I also have to go do the more Netflixy things, which is check in with the team and make sure that they're doing the things that they're doing, because I'm not used to working with 215 people on a job site. Wow. Like that's a lot. Yeah. I'm used to working with tops, a team of 10. So to manage all of that can be challenging. And it was funny, you know, I talked to some of the landscaping team that I've been working with for weeks, and they're like, "Oh, wait, what are you going to do after the show's over?" I was like, "Well, I got to go back to New York and LA. I got more clients out there for the business." And they're like, "Wait, you do landscaping for a living too? You're not an actor?" I'm like, "No, like this is what I do. Like I have no acting experience whatsoever." And they found it hilarious, because they're viewing me as like, "Oh, this must be someone who's just here and doing this because this is their job." But I went back, I had 10 clients I had to service for the fall. And it was kind of funny to see that happen. But, you know, there's a lot of imposter syndrome that comes out after the show is released, because you don't know how people are going to receive you and your knowledge and your expertise. So it was a little bit scary, but I wouldn't trade it for the world.
Yeah, I can imagine that you don't get to do that level of maybe not perfectionism. That's pretty harmful to a lot of us nowadays, knowing that striving for that is what is, you know, fueling more of this imposter syndrome. But I'd imagine there's some things you can't get quite how you want them. And then looking back, do you worry about what other people are saying about, he didn't even do this, but you literally ran out of time? Or not really?
You get used to the trolls who are out there.
Oh, I have plenty of trolls, don't worry.
They're everywhere. And the biggest thing from the show especially was like, "You cut down so many trees. Why'd you cut down so many trees?" And they're not there looking at the trees and realizing that this one is completely infested with bugs, or this one is diseased, or this one is, you know, gonna, you know, be at risk of falling over the new baby's room that we're building in the house, right? So there's only so much you can capture in a 40 minute show. So that can be challenging sometimes because people just don't see the whole picture. But approaching it with some patience and some, I don't want to say empathy because sometimes I get angry and I want to respond back with something not as kind, but just realizing like you're the only one who knows the full picture. Mm. And as long as I feel justified in doing something for a family that is really deserving and kind, it doesn't matter what anyone else says. I know I did a good thing.
Mm-hmm. You seem to, I mean, granted we haven't known each other very long, but you seem to be someone who really enjoys giving back, who, you know, I've seen you talk about how you give your, you cut, give over any leftover plants from your vegetable garden and put them to, take them to, was it a shelter or a food bank? I can't remember.
Nourish LA. Yeah.
Yeah. So you do things like that. You like to give back. You also are very good at recognizing the privilege that you have. And I'd love to know how you continue to do that as you move through a place where you're on a Netflix TV show, where you are an author and things like that. It's quite hard to hold on to those things about when it could, I'm assuming it feels like it could be taken away. How do you continue to speak out to things that may be controversial or political, or that, or to recognize your privilege and be able to talk about those things as you continue to climb up?
I honestly think that is the most important thing I do mm-hmm. on social media. And the reason is, yes, I have a plant account and I'm going to talk about environmentalism and all that, but we do not live in a vacuum. We live in a society that has a lot of flaws, and it would, in my mind, not be the right thing to ignore issues that my following and audience that supports me, that they care about and are affected by, oftentimes adversely affected by. I struggle sometimes because I know I will be judged immediately just by how I look and, you know, the socioeconomic place that I'm in now. And with that privilege, I need to show people that, hey, I care about these things just as much, and I have a perspective that is unique to me and the privilege that I have. So, especially as a cisgendered straight male, I do not see many people in my position advocating for these mm-hmm. issues. Mm-hmm. Like, it drives me insane. Mm-hmm. Like, me posting about abortion should not get, you know, 100 messages from women saying, you are the only straight guy I know who posted about this.
Yeah.
That's a problem. Mm-hmm. And I had other people saying, unfollowing, stick to plants. I'm like, great, see you later. Like, it, one of my absolute idols and role models is Justin Baldoni. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you follow any of his work, but he's a actor, producer. He has the book called Man Enough, and it basically talks about all of these roles of masculinity that need to change in our society and how to be a modern man that is in touch with their emotions and how they treat everyone in their world, not just women. And he really has been someone who I've looked at, who takes a stance on these issues and isn't afraid to speak out and doesn't care really what anyone else on the other end of the spectrum is going to say. So I want to show people my privilege is there. I don't want to ignore it, but I want to use that privilege to get resources for people and be in the room where some other people can, advocating for these issues. Mm-hmm. Because if I'm not going to use my privilege to for good, then not using it at all is just as bad. Right. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of how I view it. And I felt like I've struck a decent balance between showing people that there's more to care about than just the beautiful plants on the page.
So true. Do you still get nervous before you post something like that, that you, even though you know it's just a normal, it should be a normal thing to say?
Sometimes, but more so from the people who are saying, you know, oh, this feels performative, or, you know, this is white saviorism. Like, listen, at the end of the day, I'm out here to make an impact and help people. And if you view it that way, great. That's for you to internalize. But I can go to bed looking in the mirror at night, knowing that I did everything I could to make the best impact on the causes I care about and people who are less fortunate than me.
Yes. And I think you strike a beautiful balance of giving funny stuff and informative, you know, revolving around plant-based topics, but then also, yeah, making sure that you're recognizing things. And even just for you, I think you do it so well with just little things that you just drop in the middle of a sentence or at the end of a post that I think hopefully means that more people take it in without it kind of triggering that like defense mode. So yeah, I think you do a great job with that.
Thank you.
Wrapping up here with the book, we've obviously mentioned it's about what it's about. Is there anything else you would like to remind listeners? I mean, it doesn't have to be, it doesn't need to be about running or anything, about the book or what you want to share with people, just about the state of the world, about environmentalism. What would you like to leave people with?
Oh, wow. An open platform, a soapbox.
Imagine if you're like, I would like to talk about puppets today.
Yes. I mean, puppets are exciting to me. I do like puppets. Never underestimate your individual actions as a consumer. The reason I say that is because there's so much dialogue in this eco space that says it's not on you, it's the big corporations, which is true. But I think our society has lost this concept of duality, that two things can be true at the same time. If 10% of people decided to stop eating animals tomorrow, those corporations would change. If 10% of people decided that they weren't going to fly as much, those corporations would change. And you see it with electric cars. There were 6 electric car commercials at the Super Bowl this year. Mm-hmm. That is driven by consumers, nothing else. And if we go through life thinking that our individual actions don't matter, then we're playing exactly into the hands of the, you know, kind of very corporate capitalistic world we live in, where they can call the shots and run things the way they want to run them. So your individual action matters, and at least just model the change you want to see and just be that person, because if you're not going to do it, then no one else will.
Yes. Thank you so much. That's so good. And I don't know if you would know about this, but I've been doing these 100 days of sustainability, just a little thing people can change. Yeah. On my social media, and the amount of people who have said, you know, I've mentioned this a few times on the podcast, like they would say that they had their hand on a roll of paper towel, kitchen towel, whatever the word is. I get confused what's English and what's American. Paper towels, and they had their hand and they're like, I don't need this. And they'll go back and they'll buy some reusable. And the reason I did that was, for so many years, I was so afraid of doing those things because it's all about the corporations, because our individual voices don't matter. But I felt like if I didn't say something, if I didn't plant those seeds in people's minds, then they just go about their day. Whereas now they have like a little voice in their head that's maybe me nagging them, but it's making them think. It's like we were talking about earlier, I can't remember what we said, like breaking the cycle, stopping that habitual pattern. And it's been really amazing to see the change people have made through just thinking about it, through their little decisions that they are making day by day. So yeah, I am with you. And I think that's such good advice there. Nick, where can people go find you in future if they want to follow along?
Farmer Nick on Instagram and TikTok, it's the same. And then farmernick.com. If you have any questions, let me know. DM me with all your plant questions.
Are you sure you want to open that up?
Oh, man. Maybe not. I don't know. But I'll do my best. I try to get to as many as I can.
Yeah. Well, you do a great job. And they can now have a book they can go get to read up on that as well. Thank you so much for joining me. I, as I said, I had that was one of my favorite evenings of the year, that potluck you hosted. And just thank you for all that you do. You really are just such a good human in this world. So thank you.
I appreciate it. You too, Tina. Thank you so much.
The Running for Real podcast and everything we do here at Running for Real would not be possible if it wasn't for the Running for Real team. While I am the person who you hear from most often and maybe the face of the brand, the rest of our team are such critical pieces of what we do, and without them, I think I'd just be running around in circles with ideas. So I want to take a moment to thank our team. To Jeremy Nessel, who's been with me since the very beginning. Kat McKay, Sally Pontarelli, Kelsey Wang, Sandy Gutierrez, Louise Murphy, Andrew Basola, Alexandria Will, and Maria Vargas. Thank you to each and every one of you for all that you give to Running For Real and our community. I appreciate you, and I'm so thankful for having you as a part of the team. Hope you enjoyed that conversation with Nick. What a guy, just such a good human being with a big, big, big heart. I loved getting to know him a little bit more beyond kind of what you see on social media. You should definitely go check out Instant Dream Home if you have not already. It was interesting to hear that it really is done the way it seems. And I can imagine how hard that would be to not, you know, you'd have to let your perfectionism go there. So it was very interesting to hear. Also, go check out his book. Go get yourself a copy of Plant Coach. I have one and love it. It is so informative and easy to follow. So go be sure to get one of those in the show notes. I'll put lots of links to that. And also Allbirds. We mentioned we are both All Good Collective members, and we really love Allbirds and what they are doing. And you heard him talk about how important it is to pay attention to the little things that you are doing. Supporting Allbirds is one of the ways you can go do that. So you can go to allbirds.com to go check that out. I also want to thank our other sponsors, which are Athletic Greens. You can go to athleticgreens.com/Tina to go take advantage of that special offer to get the 1 year free supply of vitamin D. And also to our new sponsor, Oladance. I want you to go check out the link in the show notes to go check those out. I am excited to be working alongside them, and I'm testing mine out. So I'll be telling you a little bit more about it at the end of the month, but excited to update you for now. You can find links to everything I've talked about just now and in the show by going to runningforreal.com/episode328. I want to thank you so much for listening and remind you, if you can go, please leave a review, give us the 5 stars. That really, really helps us on iTunes. And if you want to go support us on Patreon, that's another way you can support the Running For Real podcast and all that we are doing at Running For Real. Thanks so much for listening, friends. I'll see you next time.